We're going to do a brief review of where we've been. I'd like to refresh because I know a lot of you aren't here for all of them. So we began with Magritte, who questioned about seeing light in darkness. Is it possible to have day in the nighttime? And Leonardo showed us how he created light with chiaroscuro, the very dramatic contrast of light and dark, and how he molded the body in this smoky sort of way that leaves no harsh edges, called sfumato, from the word for smoke that disappears. We've looked at aerial or atmospheric perspective, where you go from vivid colors in the foreground to greens fading out to blues and then to white to give you the impression of distance. We've looked at how Rembrandt kind of uses a light to guide you from the brightest spot right around to his focal point, which was the 30 coins that Judas accepted to betray Jesus. And there on the bottom right, you have Leonardo again, his famously expensive painting, $500 million recently. But I drew your attention to the way his hands, the one blessing hand and the one holding the cosmos, come forward. They're highlighted with light for you, whereas his countenance kind of fades into the background, again giving you the illusion of depth and distance. And we recall that the light that normally would be refracted in a rock crystal globe or water is not refracted. And since Leonardo knew everything about optics and light, we decided it was deliberate that anything in Jesus' hand is going to reflect the truth and not a distorted version of it. Then the last time we were together, we talked again about Magritte's treachery of images, because the gospel pointed us toward signs, and Jesus was asked to give a sign of his authority to be going into the temple, turning over the tables of the money changers and so forth, and he spoke of his death and resurrection in coded terms. Destroy this temple and I'll raise it up in 3 days. That is his ultimate sign. But with Magritte, we're talking about signs because this is not a pipe. It is an image of a pipe. It's something that points to something else, and that's what he is saying. Ceci n'est pas un pipe. It's not a pipe. And it makes you ask, what is it? It's a representation that sends you to something else. And we looked at some signs, paintings that do point beyond themselves, with the immense sky and the tiny monk down at the bottom. Clearly, it's not just about this little individual monk. It's about the universe and man's place in it. Edward Hopper uses light to send you to a different place, to question, to maybe step out of that door that invites you. But clearly, the light speaks beyond what's right there in the painting. In order to understand Hopper's most well-known work, The Nighthawks, we had to talk about perspective. First of all, vanishing point perspective, single point perspective, illustrated here by Leonardo's Last Supper. And then the two-point perspective that's in play in The Nighthawks. The vanishing points are way off to the side, which makes this little place kind of intimate and small, and the light very important. You're invited in out of this kind of immense darkness. And finally, this was the ultimate sign that Jesus gave, his death, his resurrection, and the light that Grunewald shows so amazingly in this psychedelic almost representation, where the light, you can't see it terribly well, but the light is streaming from his wounds, from his hands, from his side, from his feet. So another vision of light. We talked at the very beginning about the power of great questions, about Einstein, who asked, what would you see if you were traveling on a beam of light, which led him to the theory of relativity. We said early on that asking a good question is like launching a rock at the window of preconceptions, of old answers, old ideas. It can have That's what a good question can do. Break through your preconceptions.
Spilling
your coffee.
My coffee.
And that brings us to this character. I'd like to introduce you to Michel Eugène Chavard, who was a very distinguished French chemist with many scientific discoveries to his name. But it's his work as a tapestry maker in Paris that concerns us tonight. He had been placed in charge of creating the dyes for the tapestries that were woven under his supervision. And he began receiving complaints about the colors of the dyes that he was using. Some colors just didn't look right when they were placed next to each other. And he asked himself the good question, why is this occurring? Is it a problem with the dye itself? Is it some kind of optical distortion or illusion? What he finally determined was that the yarn's perceived color, the tint of the dye as our eyes perceive it, was influenced by the surrounding yarns that were of a different color. And this led to the formation of a concept known as simultaneous contrast. In particular, he discovered that complementary colors, and we will define those in a minute, when placed next to each other, have an agitating effect on the eye, and at times create the illusion of shimmering or movement. They also have an intensifying effect on each other, so that each complement makes the other more vivid. So what are these complementary colors? He created a color wheel, a color diagram, and this is a simplified version of it, where in the triangle, you see the primaries, red, blue, yellow. But opposite each primary, you see its complement. And the complement is composed of the two opposing primaries. So green is the complement of red because it's composed of the blue and the yellow, and so forth. Yellow has the complement of purple composed of the red and the blue. The discovery that Chavard made about the way complementary colors are perceived by our eyes when they're juxtaposed, as they are here, was critical to the development of Impressionism. And you can see, as they're lined up beside each other, that they have a vibrating and disturbing effect on the eye. Here you see the very first painting to be titled Impressionist. And it's entirely based on this theory of complementary colors. You can see how Monet used the colors of blue and orange to make the sun appear slightly unstable. We find it difficult to focus on it, and it, at least for many people, appears to kind of pulse or move slightly. Same is true of his painting of a field of poppies. The red of the poppies and their greenish background have the same luminance, the same bright intensity. So the part of our brain, and there are two parts involved here, the parts that is responsible for locating position, bless you, and movement, has a hard time even seeing the flowers. Whereas the part of our brain that discerns color has no problem seeing them at all. And this inconsistency between what the two parts of our brain are trying to put together as an image makes the flowers seem slightly unstable. This discovery proved particularly important to the artist that we're going to be considering tonight. But before I introduce him, we need to read the gospel for this coming Sunday in order that you can see where I'm headed. This is taken from John 12. Verses 20 through 33. Now there were some Greeks among those who went up to worship at the festival. They came to Philip, who was from Bethsaida in Galilee, with a request. "Sir," they said, "we would like to see Jesus." Philip went to tell Andrew. Andrew and Philip, in turn, told Jesus. Jesus replied, "The hour has come for the Son of Man to be glorified. Very truly I tell you," this is important, "unless a kernel of wheat falls to the ground and dies, it remains only a single seed. But if it does, it produces many seeds. Anyone who loves their life will lose it, but anyone who hates their life in this world will keep it for eternal life. Whoever serves me must follow me, and where I am, my servant also will be. My Father will honor the one who serves me. Now my soul is troubled, and what shall I say? Father, save me from this hour? No, it was for this very reason that I came to this hour. Father, glorify your name." Then a voice came from heaven, "I have glorified it and will glorify it again." The crowd that was there and heard it said it had thundered. Others said an angel had spoken to him. Jesus said, "This voice was for your benefit, not mine. Now is the time for judgment on this world. Now the prince of this world will be driven out. And I, when I am lifted up from the earth, will draw all people to myself." He said this to show the kind of death he was going to die. Jesus loved to draw illustrations from the natural world. And he often spoke of the cycle of the harvest, of the seasons, sowing and reaping, the seed that is planted in good soil and thrives, the seed that is sown on rocky soil or among thorns and briars and is devoured by the birds or is choked out by the thorns. He spoke of fields and farms, and had enormous sympathy for the workers who toiled under the sun in the heat of the day. He spoke passionately about the natural beauty he saw all around him, the birds of the air, the lilies of the field, how even Solomon, in all his splendor, was not arrayed as one of these. In today's gospel, he looks into the very near future, and sees that his own death is imminent, but he sees it as a part of the necessary order of things. Like a seed, he must be sown in the earth. He must die in order that there be a crop, in order that the kingdom of heaven can be realized. But we get an insight into how torn Jesus' heart was as he looked out on all the beauty the springtime, as his own passion and Passover approached. His soul, he says, is troubled. But what can he say? Father, save me from this hour? No, he will do the will of the Father and bring him great glory. But I think it's important for us, this Eastertide, to feel just how much Jesus loved this earth, the land, its people, the natural order, the beauty of creation. So tonight I'd like to spend our time with an artist who shared a deep kinship with Jesus in this respect. His love of nature, his appreciation of the cycle of sowing and reaping, spring and fall. And he shared with Jesus a love of the simple tiller of the soil, the peasant, whose life was intimately tied to the seasons, the cycle of life and death. This artist, you might suspect, is Vincent van Gogh. Some people say Van Gogh, some people say Van Gogh, and I'm just going to call him Vincent. It's my default position. In his early life, Vincent, who was Dutch, wanted to go into the ministry. He studied theology and, for a time, ministered amongst the coal miners and farmers in some of the most desolate regions of nearby Belgium, living rough, going without food, preaching the gospel, and generally ruining his health. Finally, he was told he could no longer be a minister. Ironically, he was making the local priests look bad by taking his vocation to such an extreme. but he never lost his faith. Eventually, he committed himself fully to becoming an artist whose work could serve God. Vincent felt that one of the greatest things he could do as an artist was to depict the peasant, the farmer, the workman at his task, revealing at one and the same time the dignity of the simple laborer and the beauty of the natural world in which he or she worked. He took as his inspiration Jean-François Millet, an artist who preceded Vincent by a generation and whose depiction of laborers at their work scandalized the French elite. During this time, there have been socialist uprisings in various parts of France. Urban workers were demanding better treatment. Farmers were feeling threatened by the industrial era that seemed to be passing them by. And depicting peasants as Millet did, monumentally, and this is a large picture, heroically, if you will, very powerfully, was not what French society wanted to see when they went to the annual art salon. But Vincent loved Millet's work, and when he started his career, he emulated him, as you can see in this very early drawing that is a direct copy of his predecessor's work. Sowing and reaping, the natural cycle of birth and death, was what Vincent wanted to immerse himself and his art in. And he would continue to follow this path for the rest of his life. But living as he did in Northern Europe, where the skies are often dark and gray, he failed to bring light into his pictures. His first important work, known as, The Potato Eaters, gives you an idea of his palette. If he had stuck with this kind of painting, we definitely would not be talking about him in a series dedicated to seeing the light. But in 1886, he moved to Paris from Holland and was exposed to a totally new kind of art, that of the Impressionists. Their work was much brighter, it was flooded and dappled with light, and Vincent responded immediately to this influence. The Impressionists themselves had fallen under the spell of inexpensive and very colorful block prints that were suddenly flooding into Europe from Japan, called ukiyo-e prints. Japan had been closed off from the Western world for 200 years until 1854, when a treaty was passed that ended the official Japanese policy of seclusion and opened up trade between Japan and Europe. The light in these prints was uniform. There was no use of chiaroscuro or sfumato or aerial or linear perspective, none of those things, none of the elements we've studied so far. And therefore, they appear somewhat flat and feature large blocks of bold color. There's no attempt to create the illusion of depth or the contours, say, of a body by the use of foreshortening and shading. Vincent and his brother Theo, who was an art dealer in Paris, got involved in the buying and selling of these prints. And you can see how Vincent began to be inspired by them. Hiroshige, one of the last great printmakers, and Vincent on the right. As Picasso is reputed to have said, good artists copy, great artists steal. They often featured this distinctive cropping, which Vincent will use again and again in his later work, cutting off the simple tree at a very interesting angle. In particular, you're going to see that for Vincent, as with the Japanese artists, color, in a sense, takes the place of light. And he will use complementary colors to light up a painting and to draw the eye's attention, rather than treating light as Hopper did, or Leonardo, or Rembrandt, or any of the other artists we've looked at so far. Vincent was in Paris from 1886 to 1888, and you can see here how his palette has brightened and how his subject matter has been simplified. The distinctiveness of the brush strokes and the variations in the color of the sky and the grain keep our eyes moving. We sense the wind moving through the grain, and we sense the light shifting and dappling the scene as the meadowlark hovers above it. We also have the contrast between the grain that's fully grown and the stubble that's been cropped. So both ends of the spectrum. But Vincent wanted to be more exposed to the kind of light he was seeing in the Impressionists' work and in the Japanese prints. He actually felt that a move to the south of France would duplicate the light of Japan as he imagined it, and he dreamed of setting up a house down in the south where he could live with other artists and explore new ideas. So off he went to Arles, which is way down south, at the bottom of the map, very near Marseille. And always thanks to Theo, his brother, who had the deeper pockets, Vincent was perpetually broke. He rented a house to fulfill his dream, and it's this house on the corner. Downstairs were the kitchen and the studio. Upstairs was his bedroom and the bedroom of Gauguin, who was invited to join him and finally did after a barrage of letters. Vincent went to great pains to decorate the rooms for Gauguin, and this he did with his famous sunflower series. These were hung all over the walls of Gauguin's bedroom. It was an intensely productive time for both artists, but their temperaments were very, very different, as was their approach to painting. And it ended in tragedy after only 2 months when Gauguin began to talk about leaving. This threw Vincent into a tailspin. He threatened Gauguin with a razor, but ended up cutting off a piece of his own ear, rather famously, and had a mental breakdown. But still, take a look at the wonderful work that was done in the meantime. You see his work with complementary colors, with the red and the green, the violets, the blues, the yellows, all drawing your eye around the canvas. You see his work with kind of violet and yellow, again, complementaries. That's the harvester. The fields of wheat, again with violet and yellow and with red, green. The violets and yellows would be even more vivid, but Vincent usually couldn't afford the best and most stable pigments. And by substituting cheaper organic pigments, which have now come to be known as fugitive pigments, for their more stable counterparts, he exposed his paintings to problems of fading in unexpected ways. Yellows became browns, and violets became blue, as the cheap red paint that he used, Red Lake it's called, disappeared. And you can see that in this computer-generated image from the Van Gogh Museum. You see how his bedroom in Arles looks on the left, and it's been called the Blue Bedroom. But now we know from Vincent's notes and the work that's been done on the paint itself that originally the walls were violet and the floor was pink. But since the red faded from the violet that he had created, it just left blue. And the floor, unfortunately, became kind of brown. Be that as it may, we can still delight in his work, as here, once again, you see the complementaries of red and green that draw your eye first to the bottom of the canvas and then up to the roofs of the homes and the farms. Again and again, though, he would return to the theme of the soul, telling Theo here how he wants to use the complementaries violet and yellow, especially the sky and the sun, very yellow, as he says. Thank goodness we have these notes to Vincent and his own personal notebooks. I want to give you a personal note about Vincent himself. In this painting, Vincent is directly copying a Rembrandt of the raising of Lazarus. And in Rembrandt's picture, you have the usual suspects: Mary, Martha, Lazarus, and Jesus. But in Vincent's version, the sun takes the place of Jesus, because for Vincent, the sun symbolized God, symbolized Christ, and you will see the sun playing a key role again and again in Vincent's work. We're fortunate to have his preparatory sketches for his sower that you'll see in a moment, with the huge sun in back. He worked so hard on this, working on how he wanted to create the brush strokes, the effects. So he writes to his brother, and he hopes the sower will be a masterpiece that would speak through a symbolic language, through color alone, which would make it completely modern in his eyes. He asks Theo rhetorically, could the sower be painted in color, contrasting yellow and violet together? For example, yes or no, Theo? And yes, of course, is the answer. And this would have even more violet in it, but again, some of that red lake has faded, but still you have the complementaries of the blue and the orange. You have the splendor of the sun, the amazing brush strokes, and the sower in the midst. Here we see him using a technique called cloisonnism. It's from a technique in jewelry making or metalwork, where metal wires are used to contain and separate the colors from one another. Often enamel is treated this way, sometimes precious stones as well. Here, Vincent uses flat blocks of color separated off from one another by black lines. And this is a complete break from anything in Western art until that point. Here he tells us that he wants to create an image of a yew tree, which is on the right there, but he wants to crop it just as he had seen in the Japanese printmaker's work, dramatically setting off the sower and the tree itself against the yellow and green of the sunset. The colors are unnatural, but the vibrancy of their combination and their drama, the immensity of the sun, expresses the way that Vincent felt about the scene, about the eternal importance both of the sun, which symbolized the Lord God, and the sower. But he never forgot the harvest was going to happen as well. For Vincent, the driving force, the creative force that we humans can sow in the world is love. What the germinating force is in a grain of wheat, love is in us. That will give rise to the kingdom, the harvest that God is looking for. After the break with Gauguin and the mental breakdown that I told you about, Vincent was confined to a mental hospital in nearby Saint-Rémy. Here we see one of the many sketches he made of a hayfield that he could see through the metal bars of his windows. His thoughts turned to the harvest, the little harvester there, and the figure of the reaper. I see in this reaper a vague figure toiling away for all he's worth in the midst of the heat to finish his task. I see in him the image of death, in the sense that humanity might be the wheat he is reaping. So it is, if you like, the opposite of the sower, which I tried to do before. But there's no sadness in this death. This one takes place in broad daylight with a sun flooding everything with light of pure gold. Another view from his window, a view of a different time of day, setting sun, amazing brushwork that carries your eye every which way. And again, the complementaries of the intense blue and the orange of the setting sun or the moon, some would say. These are among the last pictures he painted in Saint-Rémy from the asylum. And when he was released, he always returned to the figure of the sower, which was his last picture done in Saint-Rémy, modeling it on the Millet. And thinking in terms of the sowing and the reaping, one does not expect to get from life what one has already learned it cannot give. Rather, one begins to see more clearly that life is a kind of sowing time, and the harvest is not yet here. Out of the asylum, he created these last pictures of the marvelous cypress trees, which he loved, and of the sky, which he just divinely painted, in my humble opinion. The cypresses are actually a symbol of death and were frequently planted in and around the perimeter of cemeteries, but they also pointed toward heaven and thus were a symbol of hope, even in death. It's the final image of Saint-Rémy before he left. The fields and the mountains that flank it. And again, you have the complementaries, violet and yellow, serving to make everything very intense. Unfortunately, the year-long confinement in the asylum had made him really tired of the South, and he decided to return to Paris in 1890. But his mental state was not really up to frenetic city life. And Theo soon saw this and made arrangements for him to live outside of Paris, in Auvers-sur-Oise, Auvers on the Oise River. And so a gentler palette, no mountains, but a happy picture. Here he was under the care of Dr. Gachet, who became a very close friend. Vincent walked out into the field every day with his paints and his brushes, but his behavior was becoming increasingly erratic. This is thought to be his last picture, the wheat field with crows, before he took his own life. Some scholars recently have disputed the suicide theory and put forward the idea that his death was the result of a tussle with a group of bullying teenagers who constantly followed him around and made fun of him. They say that Vincent had carried his shotgun into the fields, which he was known to do. He often would shoot a rabbit or something, bring it back to the inn where he ate, would be cooked for him. But somehow in the tussle over this gun with the young people, the gun went off, mortally wounding Vincent in the stomach. Young people, according to this theory, ran off, and Vincent, knowing that he was dying, although it took the course of 2 days for him to die, Vincent took the responsibility for his own death, and thereby protecting the young people. Now, who knows what the truth is, but this is the book that upholds the theory by Stephen Knifa and Gregory White Smith. It's a heavy tome, but it's very worth the read if you enjoy Vincent and want to explore this theory. Theo, of course, was wretched when his brother died and vowed to make him famous posthumously. Vincent had sold only one painting during his lifetime. Even that one is disputed. And he died in obscurity. But unfortunately, Theo's health was also very fragile, and he died 6 months after Vincent. The two are buried side by side in Auvers, and their graves are bound together by the ivy that grows over them. When I visited their graves and took this photo, it was All Saints Day, the Day of the Dead, which comes after Halloween. When the French go out to the countryside, they visit the cemeteries, they bring their flowers, their remembrances, and an anonymous admirer had placed a bouquet of chrysanthemums on the gravesite. Chrysanthemums are the flower for the dead. Don't make the faux pas if you are in France of bringing your hostess chrysanthemums. The death wish, I've heard of people who have done it, and it's not a good move. Well, after Vincent and Theo's deaths, Vincent's family wanted to dispose of all his work, his notebooks, his paintings, correspondence with Theo, everything. They never gave him any encouragement as a painter, and they basically washed their hands of him. But thanks be to God, Theo's widow, Johanna, saved the lot. And it's thanks to her alone that we have Vincent's work. She's the unsung hero in the Vincent story. So those are my remarks, and I'd like to conclude, if you'll let me, with a small slideshow that I made of Vincent's work, some of which you've seen tonight and some of which you haven't, done to music. And if I can organize my technology, which is always down, you will see it. And I may have to change the size of the image.
Starry, starry night. Paint your palette blue and gray. Look out on a summer's day with eyes that know the darkness in my soul. Shadows on the hills. Sketch the trees and the daffodils. Catch the breeze and the winter chills in colors on the snowy linen land. What you tried to say to me, and how you suffered for your sanity, and how you tried to set them free. They would not listen, they did not know how. Perhaps they'll listen now. Starry, starry night. Flaming flowers that brightly blaze, swirling clouds in violet haze, reflect in Vincent's eyes of china blue, colors changing hue. Morning fields of amber grain, weathered faces lined in pain, are soothed beneath the artist's loving hand. Now I understand what you tried to say to me, and how you suffered for your sanity, and how you tried to set them free. They would not listen, they did not know how. Perhaps they'll listen now, for they could not love you. But still your love was true. And when no hope was left in sight on that starry, starry night, you took your life as lovers often do. But I could have told you, Vincent, this world was never meant for one as beautiful as Portraits hung in empty halls, frameless heads on nameless walls, with eyes that watch the world and can't forget, like the strangers that you've met. The ragged men in ragged clothes, a silver thorn, a bloody rose, lie crushed and broken on the virgin soul. Now I think I know what you tried to say to me, and how you suffered for your sanity, and how you tried to set them free. They would not listen, they're not listening still. Perhaps they never will.